All right, legends. So this is not a vlog today. We are with two big hitters of the, what would you say, the long distance, big hitters of the long distance cycling world. Cycling with urgency. Is that right? Cycling with a sense of urgency.
Yeah.
Is what Jesse calls it. But I think with this, we've got a few things to talk about. But the main one is the Indy Pack. We've got some big hitters, and I'll let Jesse tell you all about that. We're going to be riding to Adelaide for the Tour Down Under, and we're going to have some rides on at the Tour Down Under. So, so Jesse doesn't need an introduction. Well, actually, neither of them need an introduction, but Sarah's never been on the vlog before. So Sarah recently finished the Race to the Rock, 2,300 kilometres, and you did it in 8 hours.
Oh, I wish.
8 days and 6 hours. Is that right?
8 days, yeah.
So we'll come back to that. We've got to talk a little bit about that. But first of all, let's talk about the Indy Pack. Is there some big names coming? Tell me more.
Yeah, so with the Indy Pack, we're hoping to create a big showdown across Australia between some of the big hitters in the world. So all the Aussies, there's a long history of endurance cycling in Australia that I'm always crapping on about. There's some really strong riders in Australia. Most of the races are in the US and Europe, so we always have to go over there. So I thought, well, let's try to bring some focus back on Australia and put on a big showdown across the country. So we've got probably the two biggest names in the ultra endurance unsupported scene. So we've got Mike Hall, who's Mike's won everything pretty much. He's got the fastest unsupported time around the world. He's won the Tour Divide. He's won it a number of times. He's got the record. He brought it down under a mind-blowing 2 weeks this year. He's got the fastest time in the Trans-America race. Mike just doesn't know how to lose in these things anymore. We've also got Christophe Alligat, who's, I hope I'm pronouncing his surname right. He's a Belgian. Christophe is just a machine. So he's won the Transcontinental race in Europe. Unsupported race in Europe from, they do it now from Belgium across to Turkey. I think next year it's going to be finishing in Greece. So he's won that every time he started it. He's won it three times. The year that he didn't win it, he was busy winning the Trans-Siberia Red Bull Extreme Race, which was 9,200 kilometres. He won that too. Mild-mannered Belgium, but an absolute killer on the bike. And the fascinating thing is these guys, as far as I know, have never raced each other before.
Oh, this is amazing.
So this is going to be a big showdown across Australia. I know both of them are pretty motivated. They're both pretty keen. I think some of the people in this scene, they're interested. They're not necessarily interested in the fastest time or, just going back and doing the same thing over and over. They want to have a big race. Mm-hmm. They want to test themselves against the best in the world. So I think that's going to be fascinating with this, Mike and Christophe lining up. Already there's been a lot of debate starting on the web about, who's gonna take it. Is it gonna be Mike? Is it gonna be Christophe? But then in Australia, we've got a lot of strong riders over here. There's a lot of riders over here who just haven't had the time or the money, quite frankly, to get over to Europe or the US to test themselves in those big events. So hopefully this is gonna give them a platform to showcase their talents against the best in the world. Who knows, there might be some dark horses from Australia who just blow everyone to pieces. Mm. How awesome would that be?
Yeah. Do we have any idea of numbers at this stage?
Yeah, so at the moment we've got locked in, we've got just over 70 riders locked in.
It's huge.
We sold out the original allocation of 90. By sold out, it's just a little admin fee you have to spend to sign up, $40. I wish it was nothing, but trying to cover some costs. Yeah. But riders had to verify their entry. It's just like any other ride, right? You organise a ride, 100 people say they're going to show up, and it's just the same old five faces that appear. Yeah. So what we tried to build into the entry process was a confirmation stage. So people had to verify their entry, they had to verify it by proving that they were going to show up to Fremantle. A lot of people did that by sending in their airfares, just saying, hey, I booked in. Others sent in, you know, leave passes that have been approved at work. One guy even submitted their resignation letter because they couldn't get
You're
leave.
You're kidding.
From work. Yeah.
That is so good.
So there was a whole bunch of people who, about 70 people have verified their entries. We cancelled the entries that weren't verified. And they've gone back into the pool. So right now there's still around about 30 places available.
Okay.
So if you're brave enough, sign up and get on the program. We'll see you in Fremantle.
So if you wanted to ride it across Australia and you didn't want to necessarily race with two people that are going to absolutely rip your legs off, what would you be doing kilometres-wise per day? Could you do 150, 200 k's a day?
Oh, yeah. The thing with this route is I'd love it to live on as just a long-distance cycle touring route across Australia. There's going to be a lot of knowledge that comes out of doing the race about services, you know, food, water, accommodation, bike shops out there. And I'd love that to live on in some sort of open source sense so people can just take this route or sections of it and go out and ride it. So say you wanted to ride Adelaide to Melbourne or you wanted to ride Melbourne to Sydney, there'd be some good ready-made sections with all the information about services and you can just go out and plan your own mission. So yeah, absolutely. I'd love to see it live on as a touring route.
People are doing it already based on the route that's already been released. People have been going out and testing sections and already giving feedback.
Yeah, that's true.
Improving the course.
Isn't it funny how humans, this ecosystem builds with these sorts of things and it just, you get this feedback.
Yeah, it has been great. A lot of, like with anything, everyone has opinions and people love to share them. but once you filter through most of those, there have been some really good ones, some really good people out there who've been keen to share the writing in their areas. So they'll see the route that we've published and they'll say, hey, look, I see where you've gone through there, but when I live in that area and you've got to go and do this section here. There's this lovely loop we do. You've got to do that climb and head around there. And so they send the file in and I look at it and build it into the route. So it'd be great to eventually showcase the best bits of riding around Australia in one touring route.
So what you should do is start up an IndiePack Strava group. So that we can keep track of how many kilometres everyone's doing.
Yeah, look.
And make it private to only the people who are into the event.
Yeah, maybe we can do that. That's the thing. We need help doing all this sort of stuff. It's not the indie pack thing. It's a non-commercial thing. Yeah. No one's making any money. Actually, I'm spending a lot of money to do it.
Yeah.
So anyone who can help with that aspect of it or wants to get behind it in some way, they're more than welcome.
Yeah. So Sarah, you, as I said, you've recently, not only did you complete the event and win the women's category, but you won literally the whole thing because you were the only person that finished the race, which is incredible, really. You've been on the scene, on the the long haul riding scene for a couple of years now?
A year.
Yeah, just over a year.
Oh, hang on, you've been doing everything for a while. It's the same thing.
Okay.
Isn't it?
The same thing. Last year was my first.
Yeah.
Hit it, taking on the long, long stuff.
Okay.
So the Trans Am last year was my first race. So before that, I think I'd ridden maybe 400 kilometres. One go. So it was a big year last year for me.
Yeah. Yeah. And so being out there, I mean, I would be scared out of my brain just being out there at nighttime, out in the bush. You're riding massive kilometres. I mean, in a nutshell, how was it in those tough times? You know, the day six, day seven.
Race to the Rock was more. It was more about the mental side. It really was. Each day, you take it each day at a time. Take it each challenge at a time. If you're thinking 3 days ahead, you're going to shut yourself down before you even get there because you don't know what's going to happen. Based on the conditions, with the rainfall and the road closures and all that kind of stuff, you didn't know what was going to be ahead. So it was, it was a day by day, even hour by hour basis.
Yeah.
And you just got to ride the waves. You go highs, you go lows.
Yeah.
You got to make good decisions. So.
Are there any other females entered in this event, the Indie Pack?
I think it's eight.
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 women? I think we're nine.
Nine?
Just checked, yeah.
Yeah, 8 or 9.
We had a few that didn't confirm, but yeah. I think we've got 9 locked in.
Okay. And so do you have any advice for them? I mean, obviously, you're going to be just about competing with Michael and
yeah,
Jesse.
Yeah.
But did you have any
advice?
Put
to the sword. Yeah.
Yeah.
There's a couple of women that have signed up that have done this kind of racing before. Advice is it's not about bike racing. It's not about bike riding. It's about just dealing with the pain and suffering by day 3.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people go into these events knowing that they're capable of riding long miles, but it's dealing with that every day and everything that kind of gets thrown at you, whether it's physical pain or, you know, unbalance with nutrition or weather or sleep deprivation.
What's the toughest element? Is it the lack of food? Is it the sleep deprivation?
No, because food, after a while, it just becomes mechanical.
Yeah.
Sleep.
Yeah.
I think sleep's the hardest one. It's trying to manage staying awake. After about a week or so, you just start nodding off on the bike, and it's trying to push through that without putting yourself in danger. Some people are great. Some people can get by on no sleep. Some people can get by on a lot more sleep, but they can ride faster through the day. So my biggest piece of advice, and that would be for female or male competitors, is keep moving.
Keep moving.
Keep moving. It's you think when you stop, you go into a servo or you go into a cafe and you start faffing around and you're like, I don't know what I want to eat, blah, 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 blah. Yeah. Next minute, 20 minutes has gone by.
Yeah.
You're standing outside, you're eating your food, you're working out where to pack it. You need to have a plan.
Yeah.
You need to know what you want before you go in. And it's, yeah, make your stops minimal, because
yep.
20 minutes a few times a day, a couple hours or whatever it is, it's what, 30, 40, 50 kilometres.
Yeah.
You could be down, so keep moving.
Do you have any specific diet requirement? You just anything?
Whatever anything? I can eat.
Whatever,
yeah.
Whatever they make.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
So high energy. It's you can't eat too much crap. After a few days you start to feel much the same.
Yeah.
You do need to try and get some nutrition based on what is available. So it's most of us eat the same things, lots of orange juice, lots of chocolate milk, sandwiches, all that kind of stuff. It'd be great if you could survive on chocolate bars.
Yeah.
But
you lose so much salt and minerals and stuff.
Yeah.
Do you take any supplements?
I carry basic multivitamins and stuff like that, but you can't, you're trying to pack as light as possible. It'd be great if you could carry heaps of electrolytes and all this kind of stuff, but you try and grab it where you can. Lots of water.
Yeah.
But even after a while, you start drinking less water because you kind of go into that survival mode.
Yeah.
That you don't need as much as you would normally on a regular weekend ride. So
it's unreal, isn't it?
Yeah. It's amazing what you can get by on.
How many Ks will you be aiming at? Is this giving away trade secrets?
But no,
how many Ks
no,
will you be aiming at
not.
In the Indy pack every day, roughly?
The same average to finish around that 2 week mark, which is 400. So, but it's going to vary. So you could have days where you got massive tailwinds and nothing but flats, and you could knock out 500 to 600 K in a day quite easily if everything's playing in your favour. And then you could be doing the section through the Alpine area, whether it's in the snowy mountains or around Bright, and you might only average 250 a day. So
yeah.
It's you can have a plan, and all best plans go out the window in a few days because weather or anything can basically disrupt it. So, but that's a target.
Yeah.
So,
okay.
I know I can do it for a week. I've done it for a week before with the Trans Am. It's whether I can do it for 2 weeks. So for me, it's I need to move more and quickly to make up for the fact that I'm not as fast.
Yeah.
As some of the other riders, but trying to get by on less than 3 hours of sleep a night's not easy.
Yeah.
So
finally, just on yourself, what made you get into this? What made you get into this? What, you know, from riding to doing this long distance crazy kilometres?
I didn't know what I wanted to do with my riding for years. It was more so just trying to find something that caught my attention. I liked the long distance stuff, but long distance back then for me was like 150 kilometres. And then when Jesse did the Trans Am in 2015 and ripped it to shreds, that was kind of something I kind of went, wonder if I can do that in a year, with a year's notice. And the conversation started when he got home, and it all kind of just rolled from there very quickly. Felt like I had ages of heaps of time to plan. It was around, came around really, really quickly.
Yeah.
So it was a massive leap, and it I guess it played out okay. But
That's a bit of an understatement. Jesse, Sarah's not riding over for the tour down under.
No.
Because she's got to work. But Jesse and myself and Adam and a few other Curb boys are going to be riding over. And there's one girl, I think, riding over to the tour down under this year. Jesse sent me an email the other day, and stupidly, I think it was Adam that sent me the email. and for some reason, on a whim, I committed to riding over 2 days to the event, which is crazy. Mate, what am I going to need to do for this 2-day ride? And if other people wanted to come along with us at short notice, what do they got to organise?
All right, so we're going to be doing this in the same way that we did it last year. So it's 800 kilometres, Melbourne to Adelaide, split over 2 days. So day one's 450, and day two's 350. We'll stay overnight in Narracourt, and the second day we'll push through until we get to Adelaide, right? So the thing is, out there, you just have to have your shit dialed, all right? So get past Ballarat, and there's no real safety net until you get to probably Narracourt. And the safety net at Narracourt isn't really a good one. I think it's probably trying to get your bike onto a coach or something like that, and then get a bus to Adelaide. So there's no real safety net out there. There's no support car. We're completely on our own out there. So we're gonna have to take whatever we need to stay comfortable and fix whatever issues we've got with our bikes. So gotta have your shit dialed. So new tires, robust tires, a few tubes with you. Make sure you can, we're going to be on the bike for a long time. Yeah. So, if you want to come along, you need to make sure you're up for that challenge. Yeah. Because if you're not up for that challenge, and we're sitting at Dunkeld after 260 Ks on day one, there's not much we can do for you.
You'll basically get left behind.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You'll have to sort yourself out. I don't know if Uber will do a ride from Dunkeld to Adelaide.
What would people do? What would they do? You can't do much. You'd have to hitchhike.
Yeah, you'd have to hitchhike, I'm not even sure. I'm not sure what the options are out there. There might be V-line buses or something to get back to Melbourne, but it's remarkable what people can do when they don't have an option.
Yeah. That's right, you filmed
that. That's it.
Da-ding. Yeah. So for those that don't know, my dad was actually staying at Murray Bridge, coincidentally, and I phoned him. That's quite embarrassing.
It's serious stuff. Like we're always going to be trying to push the pace, stay on the bike, keep moving. It's not just out there drilling it for 3 hours and then falling in a heap and having a coffee and eating food and having a break for an hour and a half. This will be just always on the move. We'll have a few stops. We'll probably, day one, we'll stop at Ballarat after about 110 Ks. We'll stop at Dunkeld after about 260. We'll stop at Edenhope after about 300 and, what's that? Maybe 380 or something. But other than that, there's places to stop, but I'll be pushing people along. Like, helmets won't be coming off. We'll just be keeping on moving. Yeah. Because we've got to get to Narracourt, 450 Ks. We've got places to be. Got to get to the border before the sun goes down.
Yeah.
That's the first challenge.
I have witnessed this firsthand, and he is quite the whip cracker.
Well, it's not about driving the pace. It's about stopping people from stopping too long.
Yeah.
It's almost about slowing people down, because then the overall speed will actually increase when we don't have to stop as much.
Yeah.
Something that a lot of people don't realize, and when you get into the ultra endurance stuff, you realize that it's not so much how fast you're riding when you're on your bike, it's how little you're stopping.
Yeah.
The most important thing to look at is stop time and overall average speed.
Okay.
Get your stop time down and your overall average speed will be high.
Unless you stop in Dunkeld.
Yeah.
Try it. I mean, try to ride four.
Stop and don't care. Yeah. Talk to me. Talk to me. Tell me what. Tell me the story behind Dunkel.
There's a little cafe there, and she doesn't move quickly.
She doesn't move. Oh, she's.
No. I think we lost about 50 minutes last time we were there, waiting on a couple of veggie burgers and a couple of chocolate milkshakes, and our average dropped very quickly.
Really?
So
we need to give it a heads up.
Yeah, takeaway. I got in trouble for talking to her too much.
Yeah, she was
making her lose her focus.
So yeah, we did the ride over to Adelaide just before Christmas, but non-stop, straight through. So 800 in one hit. So yeah, when you're stopping at Dunkeld and you're sitting there waiting 50 minutes for your food, you're just watching your average speed just go.
So
just not cool.
In a nutshell, Sarah, what was that experience like?
This was my second experience with that ride. This year was a lot better. Last year was my first time ever tackling a ride like that, and I think Jesse suffered more than I did because I was in a sleep hole for about 10 hours. So every few kilometers I was just like, I gotta lie down. And this is once I got to a certain point where I was just, I couldn't get out of it.
Really?
This year it happened almost at Keith.
Yeah.
And I needed 30 minutes, so we stopped 30 minutes, lie down, just let your head rest. And then I managed to battle on and pull my shit together the next day. So it was nothing like the year before, but we had a colourful day on the second day with reached about 42 degrees and a lot of wind and not moving very quickly. So we actually got to Murray Bridge and we were like, We don't really have to finish this because we don't have anything to prove.
Why are we doing this?
We're like, we know we can do it, so we don't have to finish it.
Because so what'd
we
you
still
do?
Had the oh we finished.
Yeah, sure.
Because we still had the Adelaide Hills. We still had like 90K at the end to do and all the climbing at the very end. So it was this year was very different to the year before, but I still like trying to do 800K without sleep, it's not easy. So, and there was that little hold on me again, but nothing like the year before. So,
yeah.
But it comes down to sleep leading up to it as well.
Really?
So like if you're not getting a few good nights sleep before you leave on one of these rides, it's, yeah.
Because you had a busy time at work, didn't you?
It's always busy for me before Christmas, between multiple jobs. Last year was much the same. I think I'd had no sleep the days leading up because it was so hot back here. So sometimes it's whether the gods are in your favour as far as keeping you awake and all the rest of it. But this year was much better, and it was just that 30 minutes of taking a breather. But yeah, it's stuff a lot of people think they can just jump into these long rides, and there's lots of things to consider. And when you start getting sleepy, you have to consider safety.
Yeah.
So it's all very well being a hero and saying I rode this far, but if it comes at the price of swerving all over the road, it's
That's a good point.
Yes.
Good
point. So 2 days is the social. Yeah, you guys are getting it easy. Yeah.
Oh, really? So as
social.
I'm
2 day social ride.
Yeah.
So as I'm absolutely suffering out there, I can think about Sarah and that statement and feel guilty.
We haven't actually told you yet, Mark. We can get to Narracourt and just go right.
Yeah.
Two Let's groups, go. He's going.
Yeah. Yep.
He's coming with us.
Fooled you.
I would not be surprised. So, rides at the Tour Down Under. There's going to be a curve ride for everyone that can join. Should they do it through Facebook or? I've got Adam sitting over here. So.
Yeah.
Facebook Live.
There's only one ride going on at the Tour Down Under. Only one ride. And that's Thursday night. Thursday night, Belgie. We're bringing the Belgie noise from Melbourne over to Adelaide.
Okay.
So, we're going to do. It's really, you could be going on anything.
Do it on my road bike?
Yeah, totally. It's designed for road bikes. You're encouraged to do it on a road bike.
Okay.
You'll have the most fun on a road bike. Yeah. You probably have a bit more comfort if you're on a cross bike. Mm. But look, I watch the Spring Classics each year and I look at how much these road bikes can cope with. So I really suspect, not too many bikes actually get ridden out there. So the Belgie is a bit of fun. We could be on any terrain, bit of climbing as well.
Okay.
And we'll come back for some beers and drinks afterwards at the Rafa pop up.
Sounds amazing.
But yeah, so that's going to be on Thursday night. So a bit of a laugh there. It's not the only ride. We're going to do another one on Friday morning, I think, which is going to be, we'll do actually the start of the Race to the Rock route, which will have about 20 Ks of some gravel, some rugged stuff. I'll probably be doing that on my road bike as well. But I think with the Belgi and that one too, just more rugged tyres are the way to go. Yeah. Just some rugged tyres and you'll be fine.
Okay.
And we're also going to do a commute down to Wollonga on the Saturday.
Okay.
So we're going to run a commute with Cycling Tips and the Cask guys heading down there. So that's going to be a big one. We've been kicking around a few route options there. I think that'll mostly be sealed, that one, but there could be a little gravel surprise in there.
So where can people find out about this on Facebook or?
Yeah, look, I think on Facebook we'll have some event pages set up. Just check out the Curve Instagram feed as well. Yeah. You'll be able to find out all about them there too. So, yeah. And we'll be over there just riding our bikes as much as possible. So if you see us over there, come and say good day.
Awesome. All right, mate. So I'm going to go home now, Jesse, and set up my bike for this weekend. I'm going to pack a bag. I'm going to send it over via courier, all right, for all my clothes for the week. But what should I set up on my bike for this 2-day ride? And what bike should I take?
I think you're going to need a massive backpack. You're going to have your computer.
I'm going to need my dad at Murray Bridge.
Make sure your dad's at Murray Bridge.
12 litres of water? 12.
Minimum 12 litres of water in the Australian Outback. sorry, there's always... Yeah,
I can take it.
It's all right, I know. All right, so... The thing with this ride is it's not, oh look, this, I think with the whole we call it flash packing, all right?
Yeah.
Because we're going a long way and we're staying overnight in a motel. So you don't really have to take much more than a normal day ride, to be honest. But you do have to prepare a little bit because you just never know what's going to happen. We're going to be starting pretty early. It's going to be dark. So just commuter blinker lights aren't going to cut it. You're going to need some lights that are going to get you through a few hours that are going to be a bit brighter. So not just lights to be seen, but lights to see with. Especially the first section, we're going to go straight on the highway out to Ballarat. Can get a bit shitty on the roads out there, which you might have seen on the weekend.
Yeah.
Some rubble around the place, but it's fine. So you want robust tyres as well. I even put a bit of sealant in my tubes as well, so I don't have to worry about flats. I think that's important. You just don't want to be that guy who gets 7 flats on the first day, because that can be a bit of a downer. Lighting as well, it's good to take rear lights too, especially. I always like to have 2 of things. So I like to have 2 front lights. If one front light fails, I've got another. Rear lights, I like to have 2. If one fails, I've got another. So that's really important for me too. I'd be taking a quick link as well for your chain. I'd be taking 2 tubes, and a patch kit too, just in case. I'd be taking some, I wouldn't worry about brake pads or anything like that necessarily. I wouldn't worry about that. Not for this sort of thing. I wouldn't really worry about it. Because I'll be carrying one of the Kevlar Fiberfix spokes, so you can use that if you get into trouble.
Okay. And what about clothing for the night? Do I need any clothing, or should I just run the kit and that's it?
Yeah, so I don't have any problem just sitting around at a pizza joint in my bike kit. So when we get to Narracourt, we're not going to have much time. So it's going to be at night. Hopefully it'll be sort of 9:30, 10 o'clock at night. So we're not going to have a long time to just hang out and, you know, in a restaurant or a bar or something like that. I don't have any problem just cruising around in my bike gear. I'm not going to be taking any clothes because you've got to carry all that stuff with you. The least stuff you carry, the less stuff you carry, the better, because you've got to lug all that shit around. And food, I'll just be getting food along the way, but if you've got any special things you want to take, gels or bars or whatever, feel free to take them, but I'll just be getting food along the way, carrying it with me.
Yeah.
So I think that's probably about it.
Any electrolytes or any tablets or anything?
Oh, look, if you've got any special needs like that,
yeah,
that's cool. But I'll just be using food on the road. Like with the long distance racing stuff, we don't have the, we can't take all that stuff with us. So yeah. I'll just make sure I'm adding extra salt to my foods when I'm out there. Or I'll be having juice as well. So potato, in potato cakes or chips, you get some potassium out of salt on the chips, potassium in orange juice as well. So that has your electrolytes covered. So I won't be worrying about any of that sort of thing. But if you've got any special stuff that you want to carry, yeah, bring it along. Two bottles is probably fine. There's plenty of water out there. But depending on the weather, there's some longer stretches into day two where you might need a third bottle if you're going through a lot of fluid. But you can just get a bottle of water from a servo and stick it in your pocket. But that should be fine. We shouldn't have any long stretches like that. So water treatment or stuff like that, we're not going to have to worry about, because stuff will be open. If the water sources are questionable, we can always get water from a servo or something like that. Because some of the towns have bore water out there, and sometimes it's fine on your stomach, sometimes it isn't. But the main thing is, if it's been hot out there, the bore water is just stinking hot. It's like bath water. It's really hot. Okay. That's probably about it. It's just like a day ride, but sunscreen.
Take sunscreen.
Yeah, sunscreen. I don't know. Sunscreen. I'll be taking sunscreen, hand sanitizer, toothbrush, some chain lube as well. Yeah. Chain lube and a little rag. And I also carry a little toothbrush as well that I can brush my chain off too. For weather too. Oh, but look, you just don't know. Like, it's better than nothing. If you're riding out in the rain, you get all that road grip on your drivetrain. So that's going to wear things down. Yeah. Gear-wise, we're going to be starting early in the morning.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure what the forecast is too. So rain gear is going to be important as well if it's looking wet. But I always carry something that's warm, like a jacket or something like that, even if it's a rain jacket or something. So when you finish riding, when you're exhausted, you're going to be colder than you normally are.
Yeah.
So even if it might even still be hot outside, but you're going to be exhausted after a day on the wheels. So it's always good to put a jacket on or something like that to stay warm when you stop.
Okay.
So there you go. A few things to think about.
That is a few things to think about.
The other thing too is just give the bike a once over as well. It's fine if you're out riding by yourself and you've got something like a squeaky drivetrain or a bottom bracket that's just making noises. That's all cool. But if you're riding with the same group of people for maybe 18 hours,
you'll get punched.
Daft day. It's not cool. It really isn't cool. So just make sure the bike's had a once over and it's all good to go.
Yeah, okay. You've got a Garmin eTrex.
Yeah, I use a Garmin eTrex 30.
Okay, is there any reason for that? I mean, obviously the other Garmins are better. Why would you?
Yeah, look, the eTrex is more of an expedition-oriented device. I started to have issues when Garmin started producing the touchscreen devices a while ago. I had issues. I went through like three Garmin 800s in short time. I've been using the eTrex ever since. It's one of those things where you just use what you're comfortable with.
Okay.
If you're not having any issues with your particular device, that's cool. I've ridden in all sorts of conditions and in situations where you absolutely don't want your Garmin to fail. And I've just realized that the eTrex 30 is something I can rely on. I think Mike Hall, he might even have the same Garmin 705, Edge 705, that it's been around the world and it's done three Tour Divides and it's done the Transamerica. And so I think it's still going. He might have had some buttons replaced on it. But that's how much, when you've got something you can trust and rely on, you don't want to mess with it.
Yeah.
So that's why I'm with that device. So, yeah.
All right, Jesse and Sarah, thank you so much for your time. Really appreciate it.
It's a pleasure.
And I'll see you at the end of this week, and we'll see you in March. All right.
Good job.
Cool.
When it comes to TDU.